Well, good evening. I hope you still have some energy left this after this whole day. I'm Peter Gorgels, the internet manager of the Rijksmuseum in Amsterdam. It's an honor for me to present Rijksstudio, our new website, for you in New Zealand, 20,000 kilometers from Amsterdam, my home. So I wondered, I have a light in my eyes, but has anybody go to the Rijksmuseum already? Yeah. Okay, wow. And the new Rijksmuseum? Oh, wow. And what did you think about it? Let's have some interaction. Well, maybe afterwards. Yeah, I'm going to talk about Rijksstudio. Rijksstudio is all about getting creative with the masterpieces of the Rijksmuseum. And one of our sponsors, the ING Bank, made a little movie when the Rijksmuseum reopened after 10 years renovation, 13th of April this year. And I'm going to show it now. Well, this movie went really viral, so that's really great what you can do with our collection. Well, Rijksstudio is about making your own masterpieces. We made, 1 year ago, we launched a website, and we made 125,000 artworks available in iOS. You can do anything you do, anything you want, you can do with it. We present them on a website very large. You can zoom in very deeply. You can make your own collections in a Pinterest style. And well, we had a campaign with ambassadors like Droog Design. They made this tattoo inspired by a still life of our golden age. And I also have some tattoos with me. So for everyone who has a good question, you can get a tattoo, or a bad question. And if there aren't any questions, you can get, if you want, you can get one. So. Well, 1 year later, we didn't expect these results. We have now 110,000 Rijksstudio accounts. 350,000 images are downloaded. And what we really like is that people stay very long on our website, on the iPad even 15 minutes, so people tend to sit on the couch and play with the art, and that's really great. So now we can say, I love Rijks. The Rijksmuseum was a very dull, traditional museum, and now, well, it's a bit of a cliche, but we can now say proudly, I love Rijks. Without people laughing about it, so oh well. So if you think about impact, that's the word we learned from Simon Tenner. and maybe love is the biggest impact you can have. So we did this. We also, I also have some iPhone cases with I Love Rijks with the night watch on it. So it's also for good, bad questions, and no questions at all, you can get some of them. Well, this is Rijksstudio. And what we did last 1st of November, we had our first anniversary. We changed a little bit. There were restrictions of commercial use until then. And now we removed that restriction. So now our collection is totally free, the public domain collection, for non-commercial and commercial use. And you get the highest images, the high-res TIFFs. You can get them on our website. So that's really great, I think. So I'm going a little bit tell about the ideas between Rijksstudio, some results and some new things we are doing. Well, this is an image, a little, how do you say it? A little model where you have museum tools and user trends. And what I think is that you have to be in the intersection of the three circles to make a concept with real added value for users. We see a lot of, I see a lot of innovation that is in the two left circles, so from the museum and tools. For example, a curator has digitized his collection and he says, well, I want an app for that collection. And then the educator of the Rijksmuseum will say, okay, well, let's do some augmented reality. And then someone, a museum geek, says, well, then we do also location-based stuff with it. And then an information specialist comes along and he says, well, let's do some semantic web. I've learned a lot about that. And then the marketing department comes along and says, we want an e-ticket button on front of that app. So that's a lot of, well, innovation. That's what I see. So, but nobody thinks about user trends, what people are really, really doing and what they maybe want to do. So I think that's the challenge to get in the middle of those three circles. Well, I'll tell you a little bit then about the museum itself. We are the National Museum of the Netherlands. We present the Dutch arts, Dutch history, art and history from the Middle Ages until now. And we opened this year, 13th of April. We did it like this. It's a Queen Beatrix there in the middle. She opened it and there was a big party. Show you some images of the new Rijksmuseum. These are new courtyards. It's very open, very very much light in it. This is the famous passageway. You can cycle through it. There was a lot of discussion about that in the Netherlands. We all cycle, but it was not allowed to do that there. And well, after all, it is allowed still. So I will not get too much into that discussion. But It's a unique selling point for the Rijksmuseum. It's the only museum in the world you can cycle underneath it. So this is the front hall. In the 60s of the last century, all those walls were painted white. It was the fashion these days. And all the old decorations of Kuipers, the original architect, are brought back. So it was a lot of work. Man, it's really beautiful there if you go there. This is the Gallery of Honor, where all the masterpieces of the Golden Age are displayed. And well, what you see is the paintings are really beautifully displayed. We use a lot of high-tech LED lights, but there's no wires, no cables. Everything is done to make it a real beautiful aesthetic experience. And this is the Night Watch. We present in most rooms, we present a mixed presentation. So paintings and sculpture and all other kind of stuff together. So you get a real nice, beautiful history of the Netherlands. but in a visual way, not with screens and a lot of text. It's really in a beautiful aesthetic visual experience. So we are now open for half a year. So we have almost 2 million visitors in the first half year. So it's really a big success. The lane on the left is the priority lane. So it gets so, sometimes it's so full that even the priority lane is very long. So it's a challenge to keep it that busy, that crowded. But it's a big success. And we also see that in the past, only tourists came to the Rijksmuseum and Dutch art lovers and professionals. And now we see all layers in the population come to the Rijksmuseum. So we think it's everyone's collection. The Rijksmuseum is for everybody, and also the collection is for everybody. And that's also a very important point in our digital strategy. We have 1 million artworks. There are only 8,000 on display. So it is a depot. So it's a challenge to make them available online, because we think it's everyone's collection. So the renovation took us 10 years. That's very long, but we had a lot of time to register the collection and digitize the collection. So that was really great. We had all that great stuff to do something with. Well, and our mission is very simple in a way. It's the Rijksmuseum connects people, art, and history. That is our mission. It's very simple, but very hard to do. So this was our former website. It was a really, really cluttered website, like a lot of museum websites, I think. Too many choices, no hierarchy, information all over the site was too complex, and it created a distance between the audience and our art, and that's not what we want. It's also about relevance. This is a picture I took from the web, and you see it's from university websites, but you can also see the same at libraries and museum websites. On the left is things on the front page of a university website, and on the right is things people go to the site looking for. And the only thing that's in the middle is the name of the university. So that's what we see a lot also on our website, on our former website. We try to do it better now. So we think the Rijksmuseum is a very big, large, highbrow organization. We have a lot of different collections, so we are very complex for a lot of people. And so we have a new core value, that is simplicity. So we really like apps. There's an iPad app, this is like a drum app. It can't be easier than this. You just click on this and you play drums, and a child from 1 year old can play with it. So that was really inspiring for us. So we really looked a lot at apps, and we thought maybe we should make an app. But we see that only people, they use apps all the time on their smartphones and iPads and things like that. But they only use Facebook, Twitter, news apps, weather apps, and all those other apps. Well, they may be downloaded ones, but they never used. So the website has still a lot of good things, and you can find information very easily on the web. So the website is still very good, but we wanted a website with like an app, like the good things of an app. So we see, well, everybody has now a lot of devices in his house. If you're in the train, you pick your smartphone. If you're on the couch, you pick your iPad. If you're on the kitchen table, you pick your laptop. And so on all those devices, you have to have a good presentation. So it's not about the device, but it's about the task. So we want to really have a responsive website. What also is very important for us is the power of the image. So we live in a visual culture. And Well, the Rijksmuseum has a lot of beautiful images, so so that visual culture is a little bit of a threat for us because, well, there are so many beautiful pictures around the world, but it is also an opportunity to get a position in there. So the images was very important for us, and we had all that great images digitized the last years. So we took a look at the Google Art project. We liked it very much. You can be critical also about it, but it was the first website where you can really see full screen those artwork in a beautiful way and zoom very deeply in it. And it was an institute, an organization outside the museum world that did that. So that's also something to think about. So what we also saw that the upcoming of visual social media like Pinterest. So everyone is a curator now. You can make your own collections. And Pinterest was the first model we saw that was really great in doing this. So we came up with an e-strategy. To sum it up, well, our mission is art belongs to everyone, our collection belongs to everyone. We want to connect people, art, and history. We had some new core values. For the first time in our history, we had real core brand core values. And simple and personal, that were really challenging ones for us, and they were really new. And what we really want with our e-strategy is to bring the collection close to the people, anywhere, anytime, and in the largest possible reach. And the website should reflect successful trends. So you must take a look at what people are really doing on the web and go on that bandwagon and not think about technology or collection. So we want to have a website like an app, lean and mean. And well, you have to find and share information quickly and easily. Also important is that we use other platforms if possible. So we only do our things ourselves if it's really our core business. So we invented a new target group, the culture snacker, similar as the culture tourist, you could say. Well, a culture snacker is someone who takes pictures all day on a smartphone and puts it on Instagram or Facebook and shares it and makes funny things with it. And we think, well, we're all culture snackers in a way these days. So that is a really nice way to, nice target group to target on. So then we went into the design phase, and well, what's very important is to, if you want to make a concept that with added value, then you have to design it as a whole, and not all different things doing, but we'll make a strong, very strong concept. And well, if you don't do that, maybe you get a car like this. So presented some initial designs with our design company, Fabriek in the Netherlands, to our directors. And at one point in that first meeting, one of the directors said, well, I like that designs a little bit, not so much, but I like that one picture. It was just an in-between slide, and it was, well, it was a picture like this, just a beautiful detail of our of still life, butterfly. And he said, I want a website that is like this. So with no buttons, no text, only beautiful art. That is my ideal website. So well, that was quite a challenge he gave us. So then we looked again at iPads. The iPad is, you see this boy sitting on the floor. There's no device with such an intimate relation between the content and the user. So we really like that. And it's not about resolution. It's not about iPad. It's about being close to what you love. This kid wants to. Wants to touch what he likes, this dog. Maybe at this moment he doesn't see if the dog is virtual or a real dog. Maybe he doesn't know it. So that's really an interesting thing. So we looked at some iPad apps. This is a screenshot of the Eyewitness Guardian app. They show one news picture every day. And if you touch it with your finger, then you get some information, some buttons. Well, that we found it very interesting. So these are people sitting in our galleries, and they are amazed by the art, they are overwhelmed by it, and we want to really have that kind of emotion also on our website. So we came up with a concept. It's only one word, close to, and it's born out in every layer of the project. We made a new house style by Irma Bohm, and Fabric Design Company made some iPad style buttons with it. It's very clear font, very simple, clear new house style. And this is our new homepage, and a big image, but you see only three buttons. Plan your visit, collection, and about the museum. And we know that 80% of our visitors on a website, they want to plan their visit or go dive into the collection. So we only gave them what was really relevant for our users. So, and we want to bring the collection as close as possible. Image first, and you can zoom very deeply, and the information is secondary. So this is the same image, but now it's a screen, as I showed before, but now it is a screenshot from the website. And you see some buttons, some information. And if you click on the eye on the left, then you get more information. So it's the image first and information is secondary. So we want to really have that iPad-like experience. So please touch our new website. We made it responsive. It looks great on all devices. All the pages are responsive. And the best thing is that the art is always full screen, and you can swipe through the images, through the artworks, and zoom very deeply on it. On the iPad, it's really great, but if you have a 25-inch screen, for example, artworks are really great. So it's beautiful. So what we see is that much used apps like Twitter and Facebook, they refer to our website, to our artworks. And if you click on a tweet, on a link in a tweet, then you get that artwork played like this. So that's really great. We also wanted people to make their own collections according to their own interests. So we copied a little bit Pinterest, because we thought that is a great model that people actually use. So this is it is Movember, huh? It's Movember again. So this is the mustache collection. It's Dutch is snorren, but it's Movember is better. You can make, if you like the color red, you can make this, or stormy weather. We have in Holland a lot of stormy weather. In Wellington also, but you can make a collection about food. And the nice thing is that you can pick a detail, like this lemon, so you can also make your lemon collection, and zoom always very deeply, so that's really great. And also a way of getting close to our audience is that you can pick a detail of a work, and then you can order that on a poster or canvas or a greeting card. We did that with Picho, it's a Dutch startup, and they have an API that is connected with all kind of printing on demand factories. So that's really nice. That's one part of our project that wasn't a big success. I will talk about that later. And very important as well, you can download all that all those images, and we really want people to get creative with it and make everything they want. And we had a campaign with some ambassadors who made some beautiful things like this artwork on these cars. We also had a pop-up Rijksstudio in the Bijenkorf. It's the big department store in the Amsterdam and other cities in the Netherlands. And people were asked to pick a detail, and with a laser cutter they made some real nice things like this. And we also asked Christian Boslap, as a Dutch designer, to also make something, and he came up with this movie. Oh no, after this. First, Alexander von Slobby is a famous fashion designer. He made this collection with artworks, and he was inspired by this and made this scarf with it. You could buy it in the Bijenkorf last year. And Christian Boslap, he made a little movie, and I think it's coming now. The nice thing he did, he took a lot of Marias from our collection. We have hundreds of Marias, and the animation was made of all kind of poses of Maria in our collection. So it wasn't the animation he made, but he made animation of all the artworks. So it was very clever. Some other things people did, there was some design academies in Madrid. They did some stuff with Rijksstudio. And one student came up with the idea of putting traces, artworks on the traces of bicycle tires. So in Holland, everybody is cycling and it's raining all the time. So it's really nice if you put artworks on the traces. Then you spread the artworks in the whole city if you cycle in the rain. So that's really creative idea. So. But also, people are doing things like this. They just put artworks on a curtain. I took this from Twitter, just a picture. So that's really nice. We want to have people doing everything with our collection. Well, something about Scrum. We developed it in an agile way, Scrum way. There was some laughs about agile this morning. Who was that? Well, every method has its pros and cons, but it helped us really. We want to have a really simple concept, really focused, and Scrum is a really good way if you want to focus on what's important for the end user, and that, I think, is the most important thing. We had a concept, we had some initial designs, and then we had 17 sprints of 2 weeks, and every 2 weeks we made decisions about to build next, and it was really built, and then we could really a feel of what it was like, and then made new decisions. So for us, it was a really good way to make the right choices for what we want. So, well, we had a lot of good press the whole year. We were twice in the New York Times for our marketing department. Well, that's the biggest thing in the world still, to get in the New York Times. Well, it exceeded really our expectations. A lot of positive reactions we had. We won 8 awards. And the most nice thing was that we were Interactive Company of the Year. So the DAL, Traditional Rijksmuseum, was the Interactive Company of the Year in the Netherlands this year. So that's really amazing. Well, the site is stunning, said the New York Times. And it was a Dutch TV journalist. He tweeted, don't click here because you won't work all day. But the most important thing is that people are also using it. We have now over 110,000 Rijksstudios, 130,000 personal sets made, 350,000 artworks are downloaded. Amount of visitors has grown. The duration visit is very high. And we have a lot of mobile visits now. What worked not so good is products on demand. We think that people found it too difficult to pick their own detail. They don't have the confidence of a designer to pick a nice detail and put it on a canvas and pay some money for it. So we want to improve that. So I will tell you some new developments. This year we also have now an iPhone and Android app for a multimedia tool app with also integration of Rijksstudio. We have now a media lab where you can get creative with our collection, our workshops where people learn by doing. So, and our artworks are the creative inspiration. We have now an upload tool on our website, so you can, if you have made something, then you can put it near the artwork you are inspired by. So this is some technical slides. Maybe we are now presenting some presets of products on demand, because we think that people still like that we present well. You have to buy this, and we're gonna experiment with that. And next year we have a new web shop, and we're gonna integrate the whole products on demand thing there. People make beautiful things on our website with Rijksstudio, and we want to make it more visible. This is screenshot. If you click on the eye in artwork, then you see the most beautiful sets and creations that are made with it, artwork and some call for actions to do something with it. We're also getting to a new interface. We have now a lot of Rijksstudio pages. We have the Rijksstudio page, and we have all the Rijksstudios from everybody's page. And then you have all the accounts, and we're now putting that together. You have only the Rijksstudio URL. And it's like Pinterest or Facebook or Twitter. You have your own things connected with a stream of what people make, and you can personalize that also. So that's a nearly nice improvement we're gonna launch in the near future. We also have that ongoing collaboration with Droog Design. They made some table work also for the Salone dei Mobili in Milan. So that works really great for us. And we want to present our collection also at unexpected places. This was a collaboration with La Dresse, a Dutch fashion brand. And they made dresses with artworks on it. It was part of the openings campaign of the new Rijksmuseum. And you see some colleagues of mine with their dresses and two directors in the front in their own suits. And on the evening of the opening of the new Rijksmuseum, there was the finest hour of this dress was this news anchor on the most viewed news show on the 8 o'clock in the Netherlands, she wore that that dress. So millions of viewers saw that, so that was really nice. We also had a collaboration with Albert Heijn, the biggest supermarket chain in the Netherlands. And we put artworks on those milk cartons, on millions of kitchen tables in the Netherlands. In Holland, we're doing a lot of milk. The artwork of the Rijksmuseum were there, and you can collect them, and you had a little discount if you want to visit the Rijksmuseum. So that that's really nice. So the question often asked is, well, if you let people do all this kind of stuff with your artworks, is the aura lost? And the aura is the term Walter Benjamin once invented. And he talked about the real aura of the real artwork. And what we think is that there's something like the virtual aura. So if people do all kind of stuff with the milk made of Vermeer, for example, you see they do all kind of creative things, and it gets like, well, a virtual aura. And if people do things with the artworks, they also look better at it. So we think that it is really nice. And we also think that the virtual aura enhances the aura of the original artwork, because you see the milkmaid there behind all those people. It's a recent photo. So we think that the more people are doing with our collection online or wherever, it's also better for our museum visit where the real artworks are. And that's still also our business model. So we see a lot of curators. People are doing all kind of nice stuff. They make beautiful collections. It's really great. And this is Mattie Bohm. She works in the Rijksmuseum. She's a real curator, but she's also a fan of Rijksstudio. So that's also very nice. And one I like myself a lot is the bottom left's collection. So it's a guy, Mark Cregan. He took the bottom left of a lot of artworks and made a collection of it. It's like an abstract artwork in itself, you could say. So for example, the Children of the Sea, so he took that left. So and this is my favorite print, the Skating Owls. It's a typical Dutch image. Owls that are skating, and they have some mouses in their mouses. I don't know what it means, but it's a great picture. I really like it, and people find this kind of stuff. They do all kind of things with it. So that's really what the Rijksstudio is all about. And because a lot of people make all these beautiful things, we launched also in 1 November a Rijksstudio Award. And you can join the contest. The end is 1 March 2014, so you have still some time to make something beautiful. And we made a movie also for that. So, well, that was my presentation. So, any questions? I'm 15 minutes too early, so we can have a drink or have some good or bad questions.
Can the web page be accessed internationally? Is it IP protected?
Sorry?
Can the web page be accessed internationally?
Yeah, of course, yeah.
And downloads?
Yeah, it's totally free for everyone in the world.
I'm going to have a play.
Yeah. You can start your own shop with it, and this evening if you want. So.
We have a tendency for some organizations to hide their stuff behind paywalls for high quality downloads. Was there one thing that tipped the organization to allow free, unfettered access, including commercial use for high quality downloads? Was there one thing that we can take back to our organizations to convince them that they should allow this?
Well, the one thing is that we think that the collection is belongs to everyone. That's the most important thing. And if you say that, well, then you can think a lot about a lot of models, like freemium models, or we also thought about that. But that's the only argument. If you say it belongs to everyone, then there's no reason to don't give it free at all. And well, there's another argument maybe that makes it more easy, is that we think that the amount of money you can make with it is not so much. For the Rijksmuseum, it is not so much. So that makes it, I think, easier, because we think that the value, the money value of an image online is getting to zero. There are so many images. There's always a good image you can pick for nothing. So we think that there is new value if you do something with it. Put it on a T-shirt or whatever. Something more creative, maybe.
How did you go about getting copyright clearance and stuff? I mean, a lot of those images are really old, so they're probably out of copyright. But do you have more modern things? And, you know, have you had to go to the descendants of the families or anything like that to get clearance or run it past somebody?
Yeah, we are of course very lucky in a way, because we have so much old art that is now in the public domain. So we have three scenarios in Rijksstudio. So one is old art, you can do anything you want with it. And we have modern art, we can present it and you can zoom very deeply in it and it's really beautiful, but the buttons where you can download it and things, they are disabled. And the third thing is that there are some living artists, they don't want to present the image at all. So we have an infrastructure that is quite good, and but you must be a little bit bold, because there are maybe 10,000-20,000 works we don't know what the rights are, and we just put it online. If someone complains, then we take it down. So.
Who owns the works that are made in the Rijksstudio?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think it belongs to the creators.
Sorry?
To the creators.
To the creators.
Yeah.
Who are the creators?
Yeah, people who make stuff. Yeah. Sorry?
There are many creators.
Yeah, so our artwork that is in the public domain, there's no copyright on it anymore. But if you draw a moustache on a night watch or on a milkmaid, well, then it's a creative thing. Then there's copyright on it. So if you can make beautiful moustaches, you can get rich, maybe.
Hi. Someone else? No? Over here. Can you tell us a little bit about the size of your team and the group that worked on your website redesign? And I also want a tattoo.
Well, the team was really very small. We only had a team of three people. It's the internet manager, someone from marketing, and someone from the collection management. And So yeah, we had a directors that are really had a strong vision that helped us a lot, because there was some resistance to this project in the museum. So we could do this with a very small team, and we had two companies, design company and a really internet company, IT company, that they were really great. So we could do this in a very focused squirm way. And we all were also lucky, we had a grant from the bank Giro Lottery. It's a big lottery in the Netherlands. So we had 1 million euros for this project, so that's a lot. So that's getting more and more important for the Rijksmuseum in the Netherlands to have all that collaborations with sponsors and all kind of institutes to make all these things happen.
It appears you had this project going at the same time as a hugely ambitious building project, which has produced a very beautiful result. Well, yeah. Did that cause internal tension in terms of resources and where the focus and priority needed to be at different times?
I don't think so. It was. Well, the direction had a strong vision, and the concept of the exhibitions in the new Rijksmuseum, they were already there for 3 or 4 years, and it's like a visual history of Dutch art in the Netherlands, and that the art was the focus, that was really the vision of our directors. And then there were some developments like the Google Art project, like iPad. And iPad only exists for 3 years. That all came together at that time, and then we could make something special on our website with the art in the center, just as we did in the Rijksmuseum itself. So.
And you mentioned some internal resistance to the project. How was that resolved?
Well, we were lucky we had a deadline. That was because in big museums, institutes, there are often no deadline. So projects tend to last forever. And we really had a deadline. The renovation of the Rijksmuseum costed 300 million euros. It took 5 years longer than expected. So there was a very big pressure on the whole organization to deliver something special. And we were not aware of that and at that time, I think, but something happened so that we could deliver something special in that days. So, yeah.
My turn? I'm just gonna ask if there was anyone that wasn't particularly supportive of the project before you launched, are there people that have change their views on the project within your organisation now that it has launched and it's been sort of so popular and successful?
Yeah, of course, there were people, they were not so happy before, and they now see it's a big success, so we don't hear them anymore.
Yeah.
So there are also people who are against it, they are now also on conferences and...
Sure. Well done.
So you see all kind of human behaviour. I think there are still, what we also maybe is interesting to see that in some ways it is a big success, Rijksstudio, and some people they draw conclusions of it, of the success, and do something new, but they draw the wrong conclusions, and then they make something new that's not so good. So to understand if something is a success, we didn't expect it a big success like this, then it's very hard to understand backwards what is now the success. Then maybe Simon Tanner with the impact model can maybe can analyze Rijksstudio what's good or bad. So yeah. So we're still in a reflecting phase.
Can you talk about what your user testing looks like? Can you talk about your user testing, like when you're developing features? How do you test your ideas?
Well, we did some in the Scrum phase. We did the user testing ourselves, and every 2 weeks we had a demo. So, and we did a big usability testing 2 months before the launch, and we were very afraid that people didn't understand the interface because it was so like an iPad app, and we thought, well, people didn't understand it, but that was no problem. And we were also afraid that they didn't understand the Rijksstudio concept, because it's not really a website, it's more like an concept, like an idea. And in that test, everything was ready yet, and indeed, people didn't understand it very good, the Rijksstudio. So we improved some things. We put Rijksstudio on a lot of places just to let people learn about it in the website. And when we launched it, the first evening we launched, people just understood it and got to work with it. So, yeah. Sorry? Yeah, we don't know, but if you give it free, then you give up control, so you have to let it go. But the Taco Dibbits, the director of collection, he always say, if you wanna put a milkmaid on toilet paper, then it's okay for me, but don't take it off Google Images, but take it off Rijksstudio, because we have the best image of the.
Thank you very much for that talk. Here's a small gift.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Peter, again. I didn't know. Oh, yeah. Can I have a phone?